The Green Knight, written and directed by David Lowery, is a film that ultimately let me down. As someone whose life has been influenced by Arthurian legends and their honorable and brave deeds, I had high hopes for the A24 medieval fantasy. While it is a visionary work of art, evoking the medieval realities of straddling both the fantastical pagan and grounded Christian world, and its art, aesthetics, and music, it ultimately has its strong body severed from its head, within the film's weak writing and its revisionist lean on its source material, despite having countless examples of using that source material in promotional guides and interviews. It's akin to mostly everyone's introductions of Arthurian legend, whether it be a book or a movie. It's something that is so deeply inside of us. Its illustrations, the dragons, the knights, the beautiful pageantry. But then when you look at the words and try to actually get into the book, you don't actually read those stories or understand what's going on. Based on the late 14th century chivalric romance and Arthurian legend, Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, the film follows the story of Sir Gawain, King Arthur's nephew, and his journey of self-discovery. One Christmas tide, a mysterious knight with a green visage, green armor, and a green axe challenges the knights of the Round Table to strike him down, and if they do, they could keep his axe and they would meet the Green Knight 1 year hence in the Green Chapel, so that he could return the exact same blow. Gawain volunteers and beheads the Green Knight, thinking he has defeated him, but much to the surprise of both Gawain and the court, the Green Knight picks up his severed head and reminds his foe of his avowed duty. Gawain dreads this journey of his possible imminent death, but goes on after the encouragement of his uncle and his mother's gift-giving, as she provides him with a sash that guarantees no harm will come to him, thus beginning his quest. Dev Patel as Sir Gawain is often uncourteous, lustful, insecure, doubtful, and full of dread in regards to his future, which he portrays well enough. There are times where we see this vulnerability, which he's supposed to be playing, but while they are impactful in correlation with the story, they aren't highlighted enough. And Patel is really brought up to a different level because of the expressionist scenery and visuals which enhance his performance. Ralph Ineson, who plays the Green Knight, is a stoic and intriguing character for the majority of the film, but is given very little chance to play the friendly and chivalric aspect of the character that is found in the romance and is mainly used for his stature and intimidating voice. Sean Harris, who plays King Arthur, is able to capture many facets of the ideal medieval king: the compassion, the nobility, and the ferocity of it all while being put in a smaller and sickly package in the film. Like Harris's role, there are a lot of restrictions on characters like Joel Edgerton's Lord and Alicia Vikander's Lady, as well as adding in characters and whole sections in the film that don't apply to the story, like Barry Keane's role in sequence. Like, come on, a knight on horseback can't take out three scavengers. Gawain refusing to help the poor, and don't even talk about Keane's first-generation Irish-American 14th century accent. The visuals and soundtrack were the most impressive parts of The Green Knight, in their fidelity to portraying a more realistic depiction of medieval fantasy, a la the tradition stemming from the Lord of the Rings trilogy, but with more of an emphasis on illustrations and aesthetics from the actual time period. The Green Knight has some of the most beautiful shots I have seen in the medieval fantasy series since, again, the Lord of the Rings trilogy and the ultimate Arthurian adaptation, Excalibur. Lowery and cinematographer Andrew Draws Palermo have definitely upped the ante for future fantasy stories on the silver screen. Although there are some great parts of their performances, the actors have very little to do within the story that was written for them. Seeing how Sir Gawain was adapted by Lowery is reminiscent of the trend of taking a gritty look at quote-unquote Boy Scout characters like Superman, Captain America, and now Sir Gawain, as they believe modern audiences will find them uninteresting or think they can't resonate with them. Lowery's Gawain is antithetical to the original Gawain in his actions, motivations, and beliefs, thus showing Lowery's misinterpretation of the brilliance of the 14th century poet's point in order to make it appealing to A24's audience. Lowery's Gawain is a debaucherous and unkind character that wants to be a knight of the round table, but doesn't take any action in order to become one. He stays with a prostitute on Christmas Eve, neglects his Christmas mass, and he abandons his lover despite her clear love for him. His only redeeming qualities in the film are his admiration for his uncle and the king, his humility when people describe his deeds as being great and fantastical when they really weren't, and maybe the introspection he has at the end's misguided point. The qualities that Gawain has throughout the whole film, despite the ones I just mentioned, dull the true brilliance and the subversion of the original 14th century story. The anonymous poet's Gawain is reflective of the time he is created in, a devout, courteous, and compassionate knight who follows the romantic code of chivalry strictly, especially serving women. Throughout his quest, Gawain's commitment to his faith is unbending, as he often speaks of his love for Mary, the Mother of God, and specifically chooses the pentangle, which originally represented the five wounds of Christ or the five virtues of chivalry, as his coat of arms. Gawain achieves feats of renown and makes a name for himself by defeating wood trolls, ogres, and wolves, and is known as perfect in his five senses. To the reader of both then and now, Gawain is another one of the exemplary knights that we all know and love, with their massive amounts of power and skill combined with their love of justice and virtue. He's a medieval superhero. That is, until he comes upon a castle and is challenged to another game, in which the lord of the castle, Bertilac, says that Gawain must give him all of the gifts that Gawain receives from the castle while he is away hunting. After a few nights of being tempted by Bertilac's wife, Gawain succumbs to her temptations as not to offend her, as he still wants to adhere to his chivalric ideals, and accepts both kisses and a sash that will protect Gawain from any bodily harm. Gawain, the next morning, gives Lord Bertilac the two kisses, but decides not to give Bertilac the sash, finally breaching his seemingly super devotion. Gawain must become human in order to complete his quest by succumbing to what makes us all human, the vulnerability and want of something so badly that you forego your high ideals. In the foreword of J.R.R. Tolkien's translation, he states, "The credibility of Gawain is enormously enhanced by it," brackets, "the break in his superhuman-like devotion to his code in church. He becomes a real man, and we can thus really admire his virtue. By making him human, we admire his efforts in preserving his morals and faith up until that point that he has to break through those morals and codes because he is entrapped by their rigidity. Gawain is no longer this infallible figure as others claim him and his fellow knights to be." Lowry's Gawain, on the other hand, in this scene, and throughout the whole film, is utterly motivated by his lust for not only the lady, but something that is surely to preserve himself from his impending doom, holding on to those things that protect him instead of seeking them head-on because of his fear of uncertainty. Gawain is motivated by lust for honor and his fear of death, two emotions that shun the emotional roots and theme of the original text by establishing Gawain as human in order to cater the film for today's audiences. The original story can and still moves modern audiences to investigate the moral codes of our time, especially at this time in our current cultural and socio-political zeitgeist. There are some parts of the story that also seem to be picked up and hinted at, but either lost those threads, which one of has a clear answer in the text, or muddles them in the process, which will unfortunately lead to audiences being unsure of how the story abruptly ends if they do not know the context or the original ending. Characters like the romances Gawain are interesting in their both actual and allegorical aspects, which is why they are still appealing to audiences 700 plus years later, without their modernifications. Like most Arthurian legends that are adapted for modern audience, the Green Knight stuns visually, but ultimately lets the audience down by not being able to capture the heart of the original texts.